Hi, I'm Stina McDougall. Welcome to the June and July Get Outside Show. This early summertime is a great time to get out and explore your own backyard or local open spaces in search of wildlife. I hope you stay tuned for the next commercial-free 30 minutes, where we're bringing you three feature presentations. First, an introduction to dragonflies and damselflies, produced by Tom Young. After that, Frogs and Toads of Essex County, produced by Richard Walnowitz. And third, our young naturalist Sarah Spear is back, exploring for butterflies and interviewing our local butterfly expert, Fred Goodwin, on how to put together a butterfly garden. That segment is produced by Sarah's dad, Bob Spear. Well, it's a beautiful day. The sun is out. I'm going to head out and see if I can't find a couple of dragonflies.
Hello and welcome to Get Outside, a locally produced television show that features the abundance of natural resources and wildlife that exist right here in Essex County, a small county just north of Boston and within easy ride from southern New Hampshire, southern Maine, and the central and western parts of the state. Our goal is really to introduce you to some of the wonderful places that we have in Essex County. Properties owned by the Essex County Greenbelt Association, Massachusetts Audubon Society, the Trustees of Reservations, as well as the Division of Forest and Parks, and Mass Wildlife. We really want you to take advantage of these properties, get outside, see some wildlife, and really know what you're looking at. So we've offered some tips and some resources that we think are extremely valuable and are worth acquiring. Our production team is extremely talented, present company accepted. We have Bob Spear, Master Naturalist for the Massachusetts Audubon Society at the Ipswich River Wildlife Sanctuary, with the assistance from his daughter, Sarah Spear. We have Tom Young as one of our producers, who is the past president of the Essex County Ornithological Club and a former employee of the Stokes Field Guide Consortium. We have Richard Walnowitz, property manager of the Ipswich River Wildlife Sanctuary in Topsfield. And our anchors are Stina McDougall, who makes many of the presentations and does our resource review, along with Ramona Latham, Sarah Spear, and Tom Young. We have technical support from Gene Pickering, Jill Buchanan, Bill Whiting, and Fred Goodwin. All of the great wildlife that you're seeing at the show is shot locally right here in Essex County. Our show is only 30 minutes long, but if you want more information on natural history in the area and places to go, you can always visit our website, which is getoutsidetv.org. So what we need to do is get outside.
One of the latest trends among naturalists, both amateur and professional alike, is the sudden surge in popularity of dragonflies and damselflies, collectively known as odonates. As birdwatching has grown in popularity, coming to include some tens of millions of Americans, many of those who have mastered the intricacies of bird identification have turned their attention to other winged creatures. At first it was butterflies, and now odonates are the new ones on the scene. And recent developments have made it much easier to take up insect watching. First, the development of close-focus binoculars has made it possible to look at objects, such as insects, that land as close as on your shoes. Second, digital cameras have made it possible to take photos in the field and take them home to compare with field guides. And just in the last few years, there has been a great proliferation of books and field guides devoted solely to odonates. A few of these are life history books. The others are field guides. The first was Sidney Dunkel's Dragonflies Through Binoculars, a guide which shows through photos every species of dragonfly in North America, although it does not include damselflies. A book that just came out this spring is Damselflies of the Northeast by Ed Lamb. Using illustrations, it shows every species of damselfly one is likely to encounter in the Northeast. Blair Nicola's Beginner's Guide to Dragonflies, a Stokes Field Guide, is excellent for a beginner in that it shows photos of both damselflies and dragonflies and focuses on the basics of field identification. This new book by Blair Nicola and others, Dragonflies and Damselflies of Massachusetts, is perfect for someone who wants to get outside in Essex County, Massachusetts, and begin learning dragonflies and damselflies. The first step in identifying odonates is to know the difference between damselflies and dragonflies. On damselflies such as this bluet, the head is very wide and the eyes are widely spaced apart from each other, out on the end of the stalk-like head. The forewings and hindwings are of the same shape, both very narrow at the base and rounded at the end. At rest, the wings are held parallel to the abdomen. In dragonflies, on the other hand, the eyes are set very close together on the head, and in most species, the two eyes touch in the middle of the head. The forewings and hindwings are dissimilar in shape. The forewing is much narrower than the hindwing, and the hindwing's broadness is especially well adapted for species that glide often. Dragonflies, therefore, are stronger flyers than damselflies. At rest, the wings are held out from the abdomen, perpendicular to the line of the body. But don't be fooled by spread-wing damselflies such as the one seen here. Even though the wings are held out to the side, notice how widely apart the eyes are, and the forewing and the hindwing being of similar shape, both very narrow at the base and rounded at the tips. If you'd like to get outside and begin looking for dragonflies, they're very easy to find, as they occur in almost any habitat with water, from open rocky streams to fast-flowing wooded streams to lakes, ponds, and rivers. And when dragonfly watching, you should bring a net with you, as this will help you by capturing them to identify some of the more difficult species of dragonflies and damselflies. And careful netting, such as what you're seeing here, does not harm a dragonfly. When you catch the dragonfly, carefully extract it from the net, pinching the wings between the thumb and forefinger. This does not harm the dragonfly at all, as the wings are quite sturdy. So get outside with your net and practice, practice, practice. Always use caution and release everything you catch. Your patience will be handsomely rewarded, and here are some of the many species that you might reasonably expect to see in Essex County.
That was a great segment on dragonflies and damselflies. Stay tuned. Coming up next are the Frogs and Toads of Essex County, produced by Richard Walnowitz.
When you think of frogs, what images come to mind? A pond stuffed with water lilies, a buzz with dragonflies and damselflies, with bullfrogs on every lily pad. Or maybe it's memories of you as a kid, walking along the edge of a pond, staring intently into the water looking for tadpoles. Whichever image comes to mind, it usually has the element of water associated with it. And although all of our native frogs and toads begin their lives in water, many leave their natal pools to assume life in other habitats, returning to water only to breed. On our forest floors, on our small shrubs and large trees, in grassy meadows and fields, and in our gardens, and of course, in our ponds and wetlands, are all places you may encounter some of our native frogs and toads. So join us on an adventure of discovery as we explore the incredible world of the frogs and toads of Essex County. More often heard than seen, the spring peepers' chorus is a familiar sound to us in late winter through early spring. Males sing from the grassy edges and shrubs of wetlands, and the deafening volume of their collective calls masks their diminutive size. Most males are only a half inch long, while the females can reach a length of an inch and a quarter. You can easily identify spring peepers by the X tattooed across their backs. Spring peepers are one of our two species of tree frogs. They have enlarged, sticky pads on the end of their toes that help them cling to all types of surfaces. These frogs can be found in moist woodlands, floodplain forests, and in grassy meadows, where they actively hunt for small insects and other invertebrates. Their cryptically patterned bodies camouflages them beautifully in these natural environments. Our other species of tree frog is the gray tree frog. Despite its name, the color of this frog can include any combination of gray, green, black, and even white. The color of their skin actually changes depending on what background the frog rests against, as well as temperature, stress, and other environmental factors. The gray tree frog is the chameleon of our eastern forests. Its 2 to 2.5 inch body becoming nearly invisible to most predators. Insects, especially moths, make up the bulk of this frog's diet. Gray tree frogs are often seen hunting around our homes in the evening, scaling the walls and windows to get at the insects attracted to our lights. From the trees, we drop down to the forest floor where we encounter the wood frog. The wood frog is easily distinguished from other frogs by the black mask it sports behind each eye. With colors ranging from pinkish tan to brown, these frogs are beautifully camouflaged in the leaf litter as they stalk the woodlands for insects, worms, slugs, and other invertebrates. Wood frogs breed exclusively in vernal pools. Their instinct to breed is strong. These two males have drowned this female in their pursuit to breed with her. Even though dead, they continue to fight over her. Thousands of eggs are deposited in gelatinous clumps on sticks and sedges. Another resident you are likely to find on our forest floor, as well as in fields, meadows, and our suburban neighborhoods, is the American toad. Besides Kermit the Frog, the toad is one of the most recognized amphibians in the world. Their tough, dry, warty skin comes in different shades of brown, red-brown, gray, and black. This coloration helps it blend into its natural habitat. If its camouflage fails, Large glands located behind its eyes can release a noxious toxin that discourages most predators from dining on it. The American toad feeds on a wide variety of invertebrates such as worms, ants, beetles, and this sowbug. Stepping out of the forest, we enter a wet meadow. This is the habitat you are likely to meet the pickerel and leopard frog. These frogs blend in beautifully against the tall green grass and herbaceous perennials in these wet fields. The pickerel frog has dark rectangular spots along its back. These spots are highly variable and can often be used to identify individual frogs. The underside of their rear thigh and underbelly is bright yellow, which helps distinguish it from the leopard frog. The leopard frog has irregular rounded spots along its back, often outlined with a light ring. This frog's skin seems to shine fluorescent green and gold in sunlight. The underside of this frog's rear thigh area is white or pale yellow. Seen here side by side, the pickerel and the leopard frog hunts for large insects, spiders, and other invertebrates that live in these wet fields and meadows. Walking further, we find a sunny pond filled with green frogs and bullfrogs. These are our truly aquatic frogs, spending most of their lives in or by water. The green frog varies in color from green to brown to olive. It can reach a length of 4 inches and has a pair of ridges that run down its back. This is the best way to distinguish a green frog from a bullfrog, for these ridges are absent in the bullfrog. The bullfrog can reach a length of 8 inches or more. Males have yellow throats and their eardrum is larger than its eyes. Bullfrog tadpoles often take 2 years to reach adulthood. These frogs eat everything from small invertebrates to fish, snakes, mice, and other frogs. Shakespeare once remarked that frogs wear jewels in their heads, and if you look closely at this bullfrog's eye, you can understand why.
It's amazing to think that there are 8, possibly 9 species of frogs living here with us in Essex County. But amphibians, especially frogs all over the world, are in trouble. Pollution, loss of habitat, and other environmental factors are taking a toll on these charismatic creatures. Hi, my name is Dick Walnowitz, and this here is Cleopatra, a gray tree frog. There's a lot of things you can do to help these guys out. Just log into our website and find out how. Till then, get outside and enjoy these charismatic creatures for yourselves. Thank you, Cleopatra. That was great.
Boy, what great video shots up close and personal of frogs and toads. Coming up next, Sarah Spear introduces us to butterflies and butterfly gardening. I can't wait to find out more.
Hi, I'm Sarah. One of the things that I like to do during the summer months is go butterflying. Today, I'm visiting the Ipswich River Wildlife Sanctuary, where there's lots of butterflies to look for. Butterflies are insects, and butterflies and moths are in the order Lepidoptera, which means scaled wings. These powdery scales give butterflies their beautiful colors and patterns. Years ago, if you were going butterflying, you would need a net and a killing jar. Once you caught a butterfly, you would put it in the killing jar. When you got home, you would pin it on one of these boards. This would be your butterfly collection. Today, all you need is binoculars and a field guide. The binoculars that I like to use focus to about 10 feet, and a good field guide is Butterflies Through Binoculars by Jeffrey Glassberg. There's lots of different kinds of butterflies out there, and learning the five families can help you to identify them. The first family is the swallowtails. They're our biggest butterflies, and they've got little tails on their hind wings. These are our highest, strongest flyers. The second family is the whites and the yellows. These medium-sized butterflies are mostly white or yellow. They're among our most common butterflies. You might have seen one of these flying around your yard before. The third family are the gossamer wings. These are smaller butterflies that are usually blue or fiery orange. The fourth family is the brush-footed butterflies. These medium to large butterflies can be brown, orange, and some even have eye spots. Some of the butterflies in this family are well known, including the viceroy and the monarch. Another interesting thing about them is they walk on only four legs. The fifth and final family are the skippers. These small, fast flyers are very hard to identify because they look alike. At the end of their antenna, they have little hooks. As the flowers in these fields and meadows begin to blossom, lots of butterflies will come to nectar on them. Here's an American copper. He's gorgeous. See the fiery orange? That makes him a gossamer wing. This guy's mostly brown and orange. That makes him an example of a brush-footed butterfly. Fields are a great place to look for butterflies, but another good place is the forest habitat. I'm gonna go see if there's any flying around today. When you're looking for butterflies in the woodlands, look up high because they have a tendency to stay up there. I'm coming up to the butterfly garden at the sanctuary. I wonder if my friend Fred is around. Oh, there he is. Let's go say hi. Hi, Fred.
Hi, Sarah.
How are you?
Great to see you. Are you out butterflying today?
Yes, I am.
Well, you've come to the right place. The early nectaring butterflies have arrived.
I've been thinking a little bit about butterfly gardening. You put this butterfly garden in. What are some of the things that I need to think about when I want to put in a butterfly garden?
Well, the first thing, maybe, is to look for a southern exposure, so you're going to get the full sun. And then you plan your garden. It doesn't have to be very big. As you can see, these are two small plots. On the outside, I have the catmint right here.
I see.
And that's an early blooming plant, so it gets the early butterflies. And then I have chive. We have a nice flower, as you can see. And butterfly likes that color. And then you got to think of host plants too. You know, some butterflies will nectar, but then you want to have some of the caterpillars. So I have a little bit of parsley started here, and they'll be for the black swallowtails.
What if I only have have a little bit of space and I can only have one or two plants.
Well, there's one great possibility, Sarah. This is the famous butterfly bush. And this is one of my favorite plants. I believe that it's helped us get 76 species of butterflies identified on this property.
Wow. Well, Fred, thanks for spending some time with me and giving me some great butterfly gardening tips.
Sarah, my pleasure. It's been very enjoyable, and I hope you can come back soon so we can get out there and do some butterfly counts.
Okay. Well, bye. I'll see you soon. Bye. There are lots of ways for you to learn more about butterflies this summer. Be sure to check out our website for upcoming programs and information on the Massachusetts Butterfly Club. Well, maybe I'll see you butterflying this summer. I hope so. Bye!
We have a couple of books from our bookshelf to supplement the show. On Butterflies, The Peterson Field Guide to Eastern Butterflies, or Butterflies Through Binoculars by Jeffrey Glassberg. For frogs and toads, there's this handy little Amphibians of Essex County produced by our very own Jim McDougall. Peterson Field Guide to Reptiles and Amphibians. And a local author, Thomas Tining, Stokes Nature Guide, a guide to amphibians and reptiles. We're down here by my pond, where there's a potential for billions and billions of biting insects. The first line of defense are creatures underneath the surface of the pond. The salamander larva and the dragonfly larva eat tons of insects before they emerge. If they don't get them, the next line of defense, once mosquitoes emerge from the surface, are bats, birds like swallows, the adult dragonflies, and the toads and the frogs that we've seen in our show. For those biting bugs that get through, we have a third level of defense to make your outdoor adventures more enjoyable. There are lots of bug juices available on the market today. Several of them have DEET. We recommend, if you're using a strong DEET bug spray, that you apply it not to your skin, but to perhaps a bug shirt. A cotton shirt that you can take with you that prevents sunburn as well as biting insects. Another DEET product that you can apply to your skin is Off-Skintastic. It also has a sunscreen in it. For natural products without DEET, there are several choices. Naturapel or Burt's Bees with lemongrass. Or a little bug balm, badger bug balm, good for the skin, bad for the bugs. In case you do get bug bites, be sure to have along this handy stick called Afterbite, the itch eraser. It's simply ammonia which you dab on and the itch goes away. Be sure to visit our website, www.getoutsidetv.org. for further information, or email us with your comments. Thanks for watching.